Welcome to Berlinside Out, the podcast that takes an expert look at how Germany sees the world and the world sees Germany. With me, Benjamin Tallis.
And me, Aaron Gash Burnett.
Hello and welcome back to Berlinside Out, the foreign affairs podcast in association with the German Council on Foreign Relations that takes a look at how Germany sees the world and the world sees Germany. I'm Benjamin Tallis, Senior Research Fellow here at the Council, and I'm here with my friend and co-host Aaron Gash Burnett, a journalist specialising in German politics, and of course Berlinside Out's resident German-Canadian. And Aaron, this week we're talking transatlantic relations but with a twist, an angle that's too rarely taken on an important relationship. We're talking about Canada in relation to Germany and the challenges and opportunities they have in common as we enter a crucial period for the transatlantic relationship. And a period which, in honesty, the relevance of the transatlantic community in a changing global order is going to be sorely tested. Now, we still have a chance to shape that order for the better, but only if we find ways to work better together. But Aaron, as so often with the relationships we discuss on Berlinside Out, and now as we jump the pond to your home country of Canada, we're talking about a relationship that, in all honesty, is not all it could be.
That's right, Ben. This week we are indeed talking about the relationship between my two countries, Germany and Canada, and I have to say, as someone with an obvious personal investment in this relationship between Germany and Canada and also between Canada and Europe more broadly, I've been pretty disappointed the last few years because there's a lot of unrealized potential that we're not discussing. Now, when Donald Trump was first elected in 2016, and we'll see this year if it'll be the last time, I remember when Germany began seeking what it saw as like-minded partners for its so-called alliance of multilateralism, which was designed to defend the liberal international order against skeptics like Trump, and beefing up relations with Canada as another transatlantic partner was supposedly part of that. But beyond the warm personal relationship between Justin Trudeau and then Chancellor Angela Merkel, by all accounts, we didn't really see anything come out of that. I remember, Ben, as well, at an event here at DGAP that you and I were both at with our three guests on this episode today, along with members of the team at the Canadian Embassy to Germany and others, both Canadian and non-Canadian, on German-Canadian relations. One person who was in attendance, who had been here for quite some time, said it was the first event she remembered going to that was dedicated to the German-Canadian relationship specifically. And that's just one example of how this particular transatlantic relationship just doesn't get enough attention. It's easy to understand how both Germany and Canada's relationship with the US looms large over transatlantic discussions, but I think that's a missed opportunity and something we should talk about, not just when we're facing the possibility of a US president being elected who is less invested in European and international security, but at all times. Also, because if you talk about it when you're not facing that threat, then you're obviously going to be better prepared if and when that threat actually comes. However, before we get into the main theme of today's episode, there is one place where the danger of what that could mean for our security, another Trump presidency, isn't raising the alarm, and where business as usual politics recently won the day again. And unfortunately, that place is the German Bundestag, and I think we need to talk about it here today. We had a motion from the opposition Christian Democrats calling for the delivery of Taurus missiles to Ukraine, and despite there being plenty of parliamentarians from within Scholz's governing coalition we know of who privately criticized the Chancellor for not delivering Taurus, petty party politics won the day here, and only the CDU voted in favor of this motion. What kind of message is this sending, and why are these parliamentarians just not getting it? How bad does this need to get? Do they know how bad this actually looks to people?
Well, I wonder if they do, because to a lot of people inside the political bubble, we've been hearing that they did this so as not to give the opposition, Christian Democrats, an easy victory. The coalition parties claim that the CDU were actually the ones playing politics with this by linking Taurus delivery to a debate on the Bundeswehr, the overall state of the Bundeswehr as well, and claiming that by voting together with this thinking particularly about the Greens and the Free Democrats, the FDP, they would have effectively brought down the coalition. Now, I think that's overstated, but I also think it's got terrible optics for German public at a time when we see anti-democratic parties like the AfD on the rise. Now, almost all the politicians across the mainstream political spectrum claim to want to stop the rise of the IFD, but this kind of thing, where simply not voting for the opposition's motion in order to table your own motion, and then your MPs will vote for the exact same thing in favour because you put it forward 2 weeks later, seems to be exactly the kind of what you mentioned, petty party politics, but also politicking that is done by someone else, for someone else, somewhere else, that is precisely what the IFD is capitalising on. Moreover, I think the point here is it looks like politicians playing games rather than actually getting serious about our security. And that's also a message that's sent to our opponents as well as our allies. So I think while there might be excuses that are used for this, it's all been a bit too clever, and it doesn't actually see the big picture and how it looks to Germany's electorate. So that's really problematic on the domestic front in terms of what it will probably do to AfD support, or at least how it feeds into that picture. But it's also problematic on the international front because it is yet another delay to sending tourists, which has now been asked, as the Christian Democrat Knud Abraham put it in the House, has been delayed for 3/4 of a year by the Scholz government. The irony of all of this, of course, is that many of those from the Greens and the FDP saying they weren't going to vote in favour of this said, we know that Olaf Scholz will block it anyway. Well, then it's time to actually look at our priorities as parties. I think it's very clear that party politics should not trump national interest. And a lot of those MPs know for themselves, really, that actually sending tourists is firmly in Germany's national interest. Doing more for Ukraine to ensure Ukraine wins is in Germany's national interest. But they're not acting like it at the moment.
No, they're not. And I think another reason I think that we're quite disappointed as well with the results of this particular vote. Remember when we interviewed Deputy Prime Minister Olha Stefanishna several episodes ago, and then afterward we spoke with MPs from within the coalition who told us that this is what Parliament is for. Parliament is partly there to be able to put pressure on the Chancellery to act, and that the problem is Chancellery. So this is our message to these parliamentarians would be, this is your job. This is actually your job. And if you're not going to do it, why precisely are you there? So and again, the German constitution itself says that German parliamentarians are selbstbewusst. They are able to determine things for themselves. They have a degree of self-determination that is not tied to the government of the day. And right now, members of parliament with the governing coalition have demonstrated that they haven't taken this particular constitutional mandate in account through this vote. If they do, in fact, actually privately believe that tourists should be sent and they voted against a motion like that, then I don't think that they're acting within their constitutional mandate. So it really is quite scandalous to us.
That's right, Aaron. Another of the reasons we've heard being given for not actually doing this is because Green MPs in particular feel as though they would get the blame for blowing up the coalition. They shouldn't be blamed. They should be thanked. This is a coalition that is not serving Germany's national interest well at the moment. And that's to do with it being dominated by the Chancellery that hasn't properly calculated Germany's national interest, hasn't delivered a proper grand strategy for Germany's security and for how it can contribute to allies. So I think at some point, some of the coalition partners will realize this, and I'm sure many in the electorate would actually reward, for example, the Greens for taking that principled move, which would also be a power move in signaling to any future coalition partners. If we don't get what we were promised in the coalition agreement, i.e. the climate and transition fund that's been basically killed, partly by the constitutional court decision, but also by the prioritization of the coalition, or we don't get what we think is in Germany's interest, sending tourists to Ukraine, we will vote with our feet. So actually it says a move saying we're not there to be messed around. Now, that's the kind of bold political move that puts substance first, not form. And that's the kind of thinking that we need more of in Germany's international relations and its relationships, how it can actually stand up. And Aaron, before you mentioned the ill-fated Alliance for Multilateralism launched under the foreign ministership of Heiko Maas back in 2017. And this was precisely one of those issues that put form ahead of function. It put rules ahead of substance. The very name for it, the Alliance for Multilateralism. What is multilateralism for should have been actually the bigger question. How do we use multilateralism to achieve liberal and democratic ends? Of course, if we're actually going to genuinely stand up, then each of the team players, each of the members of the Democratic Club, each of the members of the transatlantic community need to find ways to stand up. And that's something we're going to talk much more about with our guests over the next two parts of our episode, because at the moment, we don't think Germany and Canada are doing that well enough together or individually. And levering our friendships, our democratic friendships, is absolutely key to securing the future of the transatlantic community, but also securing liberal and democratic ordering more widely. And so to harness the potential of the transatlantic relationship in particular, and this transatlantic relationship, we've engaged in sustained discussion about German-Canadian relations, as Aaron mentioned, here at the DGAP. And back in the autumn, we convened an expert discussion on that topic and took the chance of having them in town to record a chat with three leading experts based in Canada: Jonathan Berkshire Miller, who's Senior Fellow and Director of Foreign Affairs, National Defence and National Security at the MacDonald-Laurier Institute in Ottawa; his colleague, Balkan Devlen, who is Senior Fellow and Director of the Transatlantic Programme there; and Christian Leuprecht, who's Director and Editor-in-Chief of the Canadian Military Journal and also a Senior Fellow at the MLI, as well as a Professor at the Royal Military College of Canada. We followed that up with a targeted discussion with Stephanie Carvin and Anessa Kimball this year, which you'll be able to hear in part two. But first, let's go to that discussion with Balkan, Jonathan, Christian, Aaron, and myself.
Ben, this is a conversation I really, really enjoyed, not just because we're talking about the relationship with my home country, but also because we are talking with guests this week who really, really understand this particular relationship in our current geopolitical context, which is what we're all about here on Berlinside Out. Before we listen in, a few numbers. Germany is Canada's fifth biggest trading partner and its largest in the EU. Around 400,000 Canadians travel to Germany each year, and it's a similar number the other way around. They both share a membership in the G7, G20, NATO. It's a relationship with a lot more potential, and I often why we don't talk more about it. So let's listen into that discussion.
The last time we saw each other, Balkan and Jonathan, was at the NATO summit in Vilnius, and I'm really happy to welcome you to the DGAP here in Berlin today.
Now, gentlemen, very often when we talk about transatlantic relations in Germany and in Europe more widely, and this is a very, very, very frustrating thing for myself, a lot of people immediately assume that you're talking quite specifically about the relationship with the US, and Canada is often overlooked as its own actor in transatlantic discussions. I obviously have my own bias here. I've always viewed that as a mistake, but I think it's particularly important right now, at the moment, to consider the Canada-Germany relationship and the broader Canada-Europe relationship. What kind of transatlantic moment do you think we're having right now, and where do you think Canada and Germany fit into that?
If I may jump in on the transatlantic component, and then perhaps my colleagues can comment on the specific bilateral relationships. When we look at the transatlantic relationship and the alliance, it is being tested. It is being tested on the ground by Russia's war against Ukraine. It is being tested by an increasingly aggressive and assertive China. It is being tested within the alliance as we see isolationist tendencies emerging in places like the United States. And of course, it is being tested with the return of a high inflationary environment. All this is happening within the framework of an accelerating climate change that we are all experiencing. So transatlantic relations are being tested in multiple fronts. And that's why I think it is quite important to think about this particular community beyond just relationship between the United States and Europe broadly.
I would agree, Balkan, with some of the points that you were saying. And as you mentioned, that sometimes the relationship gets thought of as a relationship between the United States and Europe. Canadians are used to this.
We are, actually.
Yeah, we're often used to, whether it's the United Nations General Assembly meetings that were just held in New York. And whenever meetings like that are being held, we have different countries come for side visits. So we're used to that mentality, number one. But I think a couple things. Not only has there been a shift in the moment, obviously, with Russia's war in Ukraine, but also I think with the institutions that we're engaged in. So thinking about the G7, thinking about NATO, I would argue there's been a greater purpose in those organizations than there has been. In many ways, Canada, as a member of G7, obviously Germany as one of its partners, has been sleepwalking through some of its commitments in these organizations for several years. And we're starting to see, in particular with the G7, much more purpose, much more strategic purpose. The illusions of the G20 being the predominant forum that not only deals with geoeconomics, but also geopolitics, I think that illusion is fading a little bit. So I think thinking about the institutions as well and how those are changing and how we articulate ourselves in those institutions, I think is also a point that both Canada and Germany really need to pay attention to.
Let me pick up on that, Jonathan, because this point about Canada being somewhat overshadowed, do you think that's actually allowed Canada to hide a little bit and not live up to its commitments to those institutions? For example, we know Canadian defense spending is only 1.29% of GDP. That's a fair way below the NATO target, which is now a NATO floor. Is Canada's reputation as a good ally deserved?
Yeah, it's a very fair point. As you mentioned, Ben, in the introduction, we were both at the NATO summit together, and whether it's defense spending, whether it's some of the diplomatic incidents recently. First of all, I think the thing that you need to understand whenever you're thinking about the Canadian context is our geography and our geographic reality. So when it comes to free riding on defense and some of the challenges that we our ability to sort of squirm out of certain things internationally, it's frankly because we have looked at many of these defense security issues and international affairs issues as luxury items. You know, you think about when all of us go to airports and we pick up duty-free items, Canada has seen these issues as luxury items rather than essential things for their security. That mentality is changing, as Balkan mentioned, I think a lot with Russia's war in Ukraine and in particular the rise of China. But I think the pace of that change is not nearly as fast as I'm sure many at this table would wish.
Well, Jonathan, that sounds like a familiar story to some of our regular listeners. If we were to talk about Germany as well, change not going far enough or fast enough, cheap riding on allies, etc. And well positioned to talk about this is a Bavarian at our table today, self-identified Bavarian, I should add. Christian, how do you compare then Germany and Canada and their predicament at the moment and their potential to actually better contribute to those key alliances?
Look, it's a nice observation because when I moved to Canada 35 years ago, Germany essentially never showed up in the news. It was more or less invisible. It was all about what's happening in London and in Paris. And over the last 20 years, Germany has become arguably in the news, probably more prominent than what's happening in London and in Paris. It has really become, from at least a Canadian media sort of perspective, the hub of political, economic, social, even ironically secured and defense activity within Europe. As the anchor for that transatlantic relationship. And I would say that that, of course, goes back quite some ways, but has been accelerated by a couple of events. One of the things that Berlin and Ottawa have always had in common is seeing the transatlantic relationship as somewhat as a hub and spoke mechanism emanating from Washington. And of course, that is not necessarily a perspective that is shared by French leadership. And with Brexit and the UK now out of the European Union, Germany has become the anchor country that is both a member of NATO and a key sort of organizer within the European Union. At the same time, I think Europeans discovered Canada and Germany in particular. In part, that's a silver lining of the Trump administration, that all of a sudden people realize there is another country on that continent, a country with whom Germany has long had a lot of affinities, and that can serve to counterbalance the changes in the United States, changes that are inclined to perhaps look more inward, that are going to occupy U.S. administrations domestically, interests shifting to the Indo-Pacific, but also making sure you keep the United States engaged in Europe. And of course, that has always been a key component and key part of NATO. And to that effect, thinking about NATO and the transatlantic relationship, not just as sort of countries on either side of this big body of water, but of course, NATO has always had three pillars: Europe, North America, and the transatlantic space, not just as this defense alliance, but to build a Euro-Atlantic security community whose hallmark is a common set of values, is common prosperity, and the strong belief that the stability of that Euro-Atlantic space is ultimately critical for the stability, prosperity, and democracy of our own countries. But I think there's also an increasing fragility of precisely the ability to leverage that as a result of some of the failures of having lost a strategic vision for how it is that we got to the world that we have today and how we preserve it in a much more challenging environment.
I would say, though, that we're not, in Canada at least, seeing the same sort of societal discussion in a very, very broad sense, the way that we are here in Germany around Zeitenwende. That in Germany, our discussion around needing to invest more in our security, needing to, whether that's military spending, whether that's perhaps de-risking economically, all of those sorts of things, involves really the entire society, from my point of view, whether it's media, whether it's elites, whether it's the public even, seem to be much more engaged in these issues. This is not something that I personally observe in Canada to quite the same degree. So I'd like to perhaps ask what exactly is missing in our discourse to be able to actually get to a moment like that. Something that might be perhaps maybe unfamiliar to our listeners is I'm actually asking whether there's something Canada can learn from Germany here, which is not a question that I would normally ask when it comes to things like security policy, but here I am asking it. So what do you gentlemen think?
It's a really great question, and one I think as think tankers that we've been trying to put a lot of attention thinking about as well, about how we can connect not just with a handful of elites in Ottawa, a handful of our allies, but how can we connect on the issue that foreign policy is not just a domain for a few, but it's a domain for all Canadians. And when thinking about domestic issues, this is absolutely interlinked with it. So I think that we have to do a better job at this. But to give you an example, the last federal election in Canada, when we had the debates between leaders, first of all, a foreign policy debate at all was not even on the table. There was zero foreign policy debate.
I remember.
The second part,
same picture in the last German election.
Yeah, so we do share, unfortunately, some shared apathy here. Even when it came to discussions from the media on foreign policy, there was one question, and that was with regard to China. So I think, number one, it's about politically getting the attention of those issues. The second thing is actually, and I think, you know, Russia's war in Ukraine has been a big pivot point for us, is that Canadians do understand the importance of these issues. And when talking back to Ben's question about defense spending, it's not that Canadians don't get the importance of these issues. We've actually seen in public polls that shift quite significantly. Whether they're willing to vote on those issues is a very different issue. But we've seen now close to 70% of Canadians understand that they should spend the 2% promise that they've made for several years and have not fulfilled when it comes to defense spending. So it's not about Canadians not understanding the world's a complex place. But I think this basically falls down to the politicians prioritizing this. This can be made as an argument that's not harmful, but I think traditionally Canadian politicians, when they've been thinking about this, have thought that if I was to make a foreign policy argument, this would not help me electorally. And I think that that's what needs to change.
That's so interesting. We've talked a lot on this show about missed opportunities for showing leadership on foreign and security policy in Germany, but to hear that is happening in Canada as well is interesting. Balkan, you mentioned before Canada's geography. Do you think that has something to do with this, that the conflict still seems far away and that in many ways Canada wasn't as exposed to Russia as Germany was, but Canada is exposed to China?
I think Canada is also exposed to Russia. I mean, we don't necessarily think in those particular terms, but Russia is is a neighbor to the north, right? It's in the shortest distance. We're talking about a few hundred kilometers. So in the Arctic and as an Arctic nation, it is actually a significant threat to Canada. So, but also China. So going back to Jonathan's point that the public and public perception when it comes to threats shifted. It did shift, and you could see a much clearer understanding of Russia and China and why they pose a threat to Canadian national interests, Canadian prosperity, and the prosperity and security of our allies. But what is lacking is the political class. And the primary reason is that they still think that they can, you know, go to the dinner party and still leave the table when the Czech comes to go to the restroom, as I think John Manley put it. But the price of that is increasing every day. And the recent diplomatic issues and spats that Canada have been through is, or should be, a rude awakening for the political class, that being complacent in this is no longer possible. Canada has been in a place where we can rely on the, you know, Big Brother in the South and then Three Oceans and everything goes fine. But that world is changing. The public is aware of it. The experts and the think tankers have been screaming on this. The politicians are kicking and screaming, but now slowly getting them there. My fear is that it will take a much bigger crisis for Canada to finally realize that if we don't want to pay pennies today, we will pay hundreds of dollars in the future.
So, I mean, certainly some of the recent incidents have been considered rude. Whether they're an awakening or not remains to be seen. Aaron?
Going back to what you said, precisely how should you, or how do you think Germany or any other European ally should actually approach Canada and deal with Canada right now, given the fact that there's huge questions as to whether it's a reliable team at the moment, team member at the moment. We have talked, of course, about defense spending, but that's not just a number. The effects of that underinvestment are very noticeable. You have written recently, guys, about the fact that it wasn't able to participate in NATO's air defender exercises in Germany due to a lack of capability. It struggled to upgrade its brigade in Latvia. And then there's all of the diplomatic embarrassments. The Speaker of the House of Commons mistakenly inviting a former member of the SS into Parliament for a speech by Ukrainian President Zelensky. Of course, Russian state TV having a field day with that. But the current Trudeau government was also aware of Chinese interference in the 2019 and 2021 federal elections and really didn't seem to do anything about it or be concerned about it. And we had to find out about that interference through leaks from the security service to the media. How do you approach a country with that kind of track record right now?
If I could just quickly answer that, I'm sure Christian has a lot of thoughts on this as well, but I think it's to be honest. I think it's to be honest and be candid. Unfortunately, in the world of diplomacy, and this has happened for far too long on the Canadian side, is that Canadian diplomatic friends would say, whether it's around the G7 table or other tables, all the nice things, even if they don't feel that's what they want to say, but they're not necessarily confronting the Canadians on these issues. And the G7 is an interesting example here. So on defense spending in particular, Canada could hide in that table for many years. But now not only Germany and Germany's shifts, but Japan, for example, has committed to doubling its defense budget. The Italians spend more than Canada does on defense spending. So there's nowhere to hide. I think those very honest discussions, and especially with the best of friends, those are the discussions that need to be said.
This is it. We've talked about this role of playing the candid friend to Germany. And that's in many ways how we see the role of our institute at times and the role of our expert community, but we need allies to play that role as well. Christian, let me come to you a second, because you talked about something that's rather close to my heart and a topic that Balkan and Jonathan and I have talked about in the past and also with Aaron. You mentioned that the transatlantic security community is also a community of values. What are those values as you see them, and how are we living up to them at the moment, domestically as well as internationally?
Well, we've encapsulated those values in the NATO Charter, Article 2, that's often referred to as the Canada Article, and that Canada deliberately insisted on, precisely because, and I think this is really a broad misconception, and I think it does us a disfavor, that we think of NATO and the transatlantic relationship first and foremost as a defense alliance. And what we really have is a political alliance. Let's remember who makes the decisions within NATO. It's not the generals. It is the North Atlantic Council. It is the ministers of defense. And it is the heads of state and government that ultimately decide on the ends, on the ways, and of the means of how NATO will be leveraged. And the instrument here is not simply the territorial defense and integrity of Europe. NATO was always intended as an instrument to secure economic prosperity, to ensure political stability, and to ensure social harmony. And those are the values that are ultimately reflected in Article 2. And these are important values because it brings us together in what we believe makes for a stable, prosperous, just, and equitable world that we ultimately want to live in. And so I think it reminds us that this relationship is not simply a transactional relationship. And I think this is the challenge with increasing the politicians and the political views that we have, precisely because electorates, foreign policy is not a dossier on which you win elections. The 1988 election in Canada possibly being an exception. So it is the purview of kings, and so politicians treat it as sort of dispensable and transactional. And I think there is the challenge on the investment, both financial, but more broadly in the political, economic, social investment of that relationship, is that it is ultimately a premium that we pay for the world in which we want to live. And so the underinvestment, not just in terms of the fiscal contribution, but the political attention that it is receiving, is, I think, a reflection that the premium that we are paying is not high enough, not just for the world in which we are living, but the world in which we want to live, when democracy is under duress, when we see hostile powers exploiting our economy, our democracy, and so forth across the spectrum. And so that's where attention, greater attention, and why greater attention is ultimately necessary.
And if I may just add a 10-second addition to, to what Christian said, in the sense that the purpose of that political community is to move beyond narrow, myopic self-interest to a broader, enlightened national interest by creating an environment in which we can prosper by paying that particular premium. And we don't, we pay a lot more down the road, both in blood and treasure.
It's a long 10 seconds, but we'll allow it because it's so important.
It's a transatlantic segment.
No, this is really important stuff. Thank you both for raising that. Christian, I think this is really important to emphasize because not a lot of people look back to that function of NATO during the Cold War, where it was a political community as much as anything, where you saw the socialization effects on the countries that were involved and the statespeople involved, which allowed for the exertion of a high-level peer pressure, this collective spine stiffness that actually allowed particular countries to ride out domestic political waverings. I mean, Germany being prime among them, facing constant pressure at home to not contribute to the alliance. But because of the pressure of allies and the positive role they played as candid friends, chancellor after chancellor could use that to say to the German people, no, this is what we have to do, and here's why. As a frontline state, this is where we are. We depend on them. They depend on us. So this is an extremely important part of that. It's also interesting, you mentioned that we're paying a premium for this. This is exactly how Aaron and I talk about this. And this national security premium comes in defense terms, but it also comes in other terms, doesn't it, Aaron?
Yeah, it does. And actually, this comes from a Handelsblatt article with EU Commissioner Margaret Vestager. And she referred actually to a national security premium. And that is where Western democratic countries need to basically get more comfortable with paying a bit more to trade with like-minded, friendly countries. And she mentioned Canada in particular. And she said, Canada has almost all the raw materials we need, but the companies there need a long-term perspective from us, meaning Europe, to invest. Is Canada really well-placed, in your view, to be, I guess, an energy or food superpower and help its allies out with that national security premium?
Both Johnson and Christian has ideas on this, because as an institute, we have been arguing for this particular positioning. That Canada can play a significant role when it comes to energy and food and supporting their, its allies for a long while.
And it's interesting, Balkan, to note in that regard that actually one of Germany's main exports to Canada is food rather than the other way around.
I would assume that's something to do with the EU regulations and the fact that you like your farms closer rather than far away. To me, though, going back to it, can Canada play this role? When you look at the available resources, yes. And when you look at the people who are working in that particular field, be it energy, be it food, agriculture, be it minerals and mining, yes, they do. But what is the biggest obstacle to it? It's regulation and it's the political class. Our colleague, Hedrek Snapirot, says that it takes 15 years from start to the production to get a mine online in Canada. No one will wait for that. We can't build pipelines because there are 28 different veto players from provincial governments to local government to federal government and to others. It is not possible to build things, to get those resources out. And that is the primary problem. When Chancellor Scholz came and asked for quite frankly, more Canadian energy, Canadian LNG. Prime Minister Trudeau says there is no business case. Well, there is a business case, but there is a big, big political obstacle out there.
You know, and this is not unique only to the German relationship. The same thing happened. Prime Minister Kishida in Japan came shortly after Chancellor Schultz and came back with nothing on energy. I think the important thing to think about is comparative advantages. So it's not that our allies, whether it's in the transatlantic sphere or in Asia, don't want more Canadian hard security, traditional security presence. But what is the comparative advantage that Canada can bring? And I think, as Balkan referenced often, and what's the demand signals from our allies and partners? That is on agriculture, that is on mining, that is on energy security. So this is the area that we can have the biggest difference. And unfortunately, time after time, because of regulation, because of red tape, because of different government policies on this, we haven't been able to fulfill that. But I wanted to just quickly come back, because I think this is linked into national security culture. So we talked about the insurance premium, which I think is the premium on national security. I would argue it's not just the amount of dollars that you're spending too. And this goes in, energy security is a part of it. I think agriculture is a part of it too. It's the way strategically that you have a culture of thinking about national security. And at least from the Canadian context, and Christian, maybe this is a good segue for you, because you spend a lot of time on this. I just don't think we have that evolved sort of mindset on national security that thinks in the big picture, that doesn't just think about traditional intelligence, traditional national defense. Getting those minds together, whether it's in a National Security Council mindset, whether it's in civil society as well, which I don't think we've nurtured as much. So I think these are areas that we really need to work on as a country.
Just coming back quickly to Chancellor Schultz's visit, I remember when Justin Trudeau said there was no business case for Canadian LNG to go to Europe. And I will tell you, as a Western Canadian, that no one from where I'm from believes this. Like, no one took that comment seriously. So this is interesting, for our listeners. This gets into a little bit of whether something is possible in Canada or not can often depend on who you ask. And it becomes a very regional question. We do have potentially two elections transatlantically coming up that could be quite significant for transatlantic relations. We obviously have a big presidential election in the U.S., but also in the next few years at least, we will probably see a general election in Canada. And all current polls, at least at the moment, indicate that the Liberal Party could lose quite badly to the Conservatives. Keeping both of these elections in mind, how should Germany and other European allies sort of plan or game out their relationship with Canada, given that political context?
So national interests are fairly immutable. So Canada's national interests haven't much changed over the years, neither in terms of its key sort of strategic alliance with the United States, nor its sort of secondary alliance and strategic relationship with Europe. And so as a middle power, Canada has an interest in international stability, in the rules-based international order, in stable trade relationships, and in sort of a somewhat predictable sort of human rights regime internationally. These are, I think, elements that necessarily bring Canada and Germany together. The difference here, I would say, in terms of sort of these upcoming elections, is that Canada as a middle power is ultimately dispensable. And that is, I think, a problem that most Canadian politicians and hardly any Canadians realize. Every citizen in every country always thinks that their country necessarily matters. But the reality is that strategically, Canada does not matter. And so when you have a government that does not pull its fair weight in perception, at least, if not reality, on security, when you have a government that is being asked to contribute to regional and global prosperity and economic stability through its energy exports, and the government says we're not interested, when a government whose democratic institutions are actively being interfered with and meddled with turns a blind eye and in the process emboldens other actors to interfere even more in those institutions.
Are you speaking specifically about the Chinese here?
Well, I speak about the contradiction that the current government seems to not understand national security when you have an existential potential threat to Canada's democratic institutions by an adversary. And yet this is not the threat the government speaks up on. The threat that it speaks up on is purportedly as objectionable as one could think in terms of an extrajudicial, extraterritorial assassination on Canadian soil. But that does not pose an existential threat to Canada, to the democratic way of life, or to Canadian security. I think the challenge here is that allies such as Germany are looking at Canada and increasingly feeling we're going to have to go it without Canada. And that is a very dangerous moment for Canada, because it means that Canada can no longer leverage multilateral institutions and its relationship with, in particular, Germany, the European Union, and NATO on the one hand to balance the United States, on the other hand to assert its interests. But I think it's also a really interesting moment for Germany, because Canada allows Germany to claim that Germany is a middle power. Of course, Henry Kissinger's famous quote that Germany is too large for Europe, too small for the world. But Germany is certainly more than a middle power. And so what Canada's recalcitrant attitude will force Germany to do is for Germany to become a more forceful actor, both within the region and within the world, thereby, I think, cementing perhaps a more European approach to the world and a more American approach to the world. And nothing is more dangerous for Canada than that, because it means that Canada will no longer have the leverage it had for the recent decades with either the United States or Europe.
Thanks, Christian. I mean, yes, we look forward to the next Canadian election and see which party seizes upon that slogan, Canada, ultimately dispensable, for their campaign. But I think this is a really, it's such an interesting point, because that doesn't have to be the case. It's not necessarily so. As we've heard from all of you, the potential is there, but the political connecting up and will to actually realize that potential is not. And again, that's a bit of a familiar story to many of us in this part of the world. And it seems also, I mean, we've talked a lot on this show about team power and how to be a team player. And Jonathan, what you mentioned before about what are Canada's strengths, I mean, a good team lets the strengths of each player shine and realizes that they compensate for each other. And also team players, good ones, cover up each other's weaknesses. So rather than giving each other a place to hide, we should be pushing each other forward, because there would be only to gain for that community of values, Christian, that you mentioned before, which is under threat. But I wonder also if we're selling the domestic side of this a little short in our analysis so far, because this reason to pay the national security premium, why should people pay that unless they actually understand that as being an investment in a better future and in a future that's safe for the democratic world, but also of their own freedom, their own flourishing, and a material betterment? I think this is the real challenge that we're facing at the moment, to actually combine those geopolitical challenges with the ecological transition that we're going through and the geoeconomic and technological transitions. And that speaks as much to the regulatory challenges you mentioned before, but also to the NIMBY, not in my backyard kind of attitude that is reluctant to get those resources out of the ground in countries that are friendly to democracy. We face the same challenge here in Germany. The question for us, I suppose, is how to overcome that.
It is a two-pronged thing. I mean, there is a number of things that we can do as scholars, as think tankers, as public intellectuals, trying to shift the debate, change the temperature of the water that the politicians swim in, and thus they react to it. But fundamentally, it is also a symbiotic relationship in which the political leadership needs to show leadership, right? Incentives are important. I'm a big believer of incentives. And like everyone else, politicians do act according to incentives. So you have to be able to align the long-term interests that we are talking about with the short-term interests of the politicians. Now, that goes through by changing the temperature of that water that they play in. So there is something in that sense what we can do. But the other part needs to be the leadership leading, right? Taking part and bringing the public together, because otherwise we will end up doing the right thing, but at a much higher price. Partly because humans in general are terrible at thinking about long-term threats. You always prefer, most of the time, the short-term benefits to the long-term benefits if it costs you more, et cetera, et cetera. Unless the public faces either a leadership that explains this and leads front by making the case to the public, or facing a situation where the crisis is so obvious Russia's war against Ukraine is the biggest one. When we talk about it, there is, as the saying goes, there is no such a thing as cheap Russian gas. You pay the price eventually, right? The question is whether you pay the price up front or you pay the price down the road by treasure and blood.
And that's right. And even the German national security strategy, which isn't terribly strategic in all honesty, does acknowledge that. It says that Germany paid double for Russian gas, and it's absolutely right to. And so this deficit in leadership is something we think about a lot, and the unwillingness to put forward a vision, to explain to people. We had Ben Hodges on the show recently advising German politicians to say, don't talk to your electorate like they're children. Tell them what the risks are, but also tell them what the risks of inaction are. And I think a key part of strategizing is realizing what decisions you're going to have to make anyway and making them on your terms as much as possible. And that's not something we've really seen so far. And exactly what you said, Balkan, it's been mainly politicians being pushed into things that something that was impossible becomes inevitable. And then it's done in bad conditions, rather than actually looking ahead and seeing that.
So to build on Balkan's point, I think effectively, we've gotten into a situation, and Canada, again, is not unique to this, that something can be in the public interest, but it's not in the political interest. And you can have something that's in the public interest, the politicians recognize it's in the public interest, but there's not enough of a demand signal. There's not enough of a voice that it's going to matter in the elections. And that's the challenge, whether it's defense spending, whether it's energy security, where there's a recognition that perhaps this is in the public interest. But when politicians don't realize it's in their political interest, it's the challenge. And just getting back to how we can sort of address this issue and looking at the United States, I actually think one of the benefits, and Ben, you talked a bit about the years of the Trump administration. I think this was just one example of this, where many countries like Canada and Germany started thinking about, maybe I should be having closer relationships outside of the United States. Maybe I should be thinking about, for example, Canada-Germany or Canada-Japan relations. I actually think it's a very positive element, because now we can recognize different ways to lever pressure on the United States. It doesn't always work. But in interesting way, the hub and spoke model that we talked about before, the United States actually has been pushing this for several years. They've actually been advocating for a networked approach, whether it's on security issues. So this actually provides a very interesting platform for that.
It sure does. And indeed, that fits with the agenda to actually internationalize the liberal international order, so that it's not an American hegemonic order, but actually one where those who have an interest in it, who recognize that their national interests are fundamentally internationally constituted, that they depend on that order and can benefit from it, actually shoulder some of the burden for the thinking and the doing that would continue that form of ordering.
So if you are, for example, sitting next to a few people in the German administration, and you have a new Canadian government, which we may indeed have in the next couple of years, what would you sort of advise them to do in terms of potential opportunities that might exist right off the bat before the new administration sort of gets bogged down by everything else that happens when a new administration takes office?
I would say, going back to what we said and Jonathan highlighted, the fact that, be frank, pop the bubble around self-satisfied notion that Canada is a great international citizen and is broadly liked and always do the right thing, and governance by announcement is enough. You don't have to follow through those announcements. Be frank, we are expecting X, Y, and Z. This is our common interests are, and you're not delivering so far.
That sounds familiar, doesn't it?
There's a couple of opportunities, right? So I think one of the things that has dramatically changed from the Cold War is, in the Cold War, it was clear who the adversary was, right? So it's easy to marshal public opinion. We live in an era where threats are diffuse. They're not necessarily kinetic. They're not necessarily visible. And the cumulative effects, where our adversaries are effectively undermining us, not with sort of one direct kinetic sort of threat per se, but broadly looking to undermine our prosperity, our way of life, our institutions. And so I think one opportunity is that just getting politicians to actually understand that. I think the complexity of the security environment is partially what makes politicians increasingly actually opt out of security policy, because they look at it and they go, oh, this is too hard. We'll just leave it to the security professionals.
I mean, this is an interesting point in relation to the German national security strategy. The concept of integrated security is excellent for taking a broad view of potential security challenges, but without prioritization, without decision, everything is security and nothing is security.
I think the other opportunity is, of course, to make politicians think differently about the era in which we live. I think most people in their minds still live in this post-Cold War, democracy as one, capitalism as one, and we're all going to live happily ever after in this liberal democratic wonderland.
The end of history is...
Yeah, or what we refer to in the context of Germany as the world of yesterday.
Because it's of course, inherently appealing, on the one hand, to human nature, and on the other hand, of course, humans think of it in terms of continuity, they don't think in terms of disruption. Whereas I personally think it is much more useful to think about today as 1935. If you talk to my friends in the Indo-Pacific, they believe very firmly that in the next 5 to 8 years, there will be a major war. And that war, just like we say today, that the stability of Europe and the transatlantic space is directly linked to stability and peace in the Indo-Pacific. If there's war in the Indo-Pacific, you can bet that the kleptocracy in Moscow will be the first ones that are going to exploit that situation, that circumstance, and U.S. distraction in Europe. And I think this is the opportunity where, if we think about 1935, different countries in Europe made very different decisions to prepare for that eventuality. And so what does that alternative future, what does that horizon look like? And how do we need to prepare for that horizon today? And why do we prepare for war so that we can preserve the peace that we have?
Let's talk about that quickly, because Canada recently released an Indo-Pacific strategy calling China an increasingly disruptive actor, right as many European countries, including Germany, are talking about de-risking their supply chains. We have talked about this on the podcast before, and we will be returning to this theme in future episodes. Critical infrastructure, raw materials, supply chains, moving these away from China. Is there room for Canada and Europe to find more common ground on this kind of question and these kinds of strategies? And if so, where?
Let me go first on this. I think absolutely. I mean, first of all, having been a former Canadian bureaucrat who worked on Asia for several years, this was long awaited. So recently we started using the terminology Indo-Pacific, and it's a buzzword for many of our allies. But the thinking about needing a much more comprehensive strategy for Asia has been long overdue, as you referenced, the realistic assessment of China and its destabilizing activities. As it relates to European friends and how we can work hand in hand with Canada, I think there's many areas, whether it's energy security, whether it's critical minerals. I also think even in contingencies, going back to Christian's point, I think we need to own some of these security issues. Canadians for too long have been sort of complacent and effectively waiting for the Americans to come in to help us out. If you think about a contingency over Taiwan, we know that the Americans are going to be taking care of their own first. They have their own citizens that they have to take care of.
It's very good to see more Indo-Pacific strategies being developed, but what we really need are inter-Pacific strategies to link those theaters, to link the Atlantic and the Pacific. And I think it's become increasingly clear to many people that unless we tie down security in Europe properly, unless Ukraine wins and settles that security question with Russia for the foreseeable future, then we would actually be weakening the United States' ability to deal with China, or putting ourselves at great risk in Europe and in the Euro-Atlantic security area, because the US would not prioritize that. As you said, Jonathan, they're going to take care of their priorities first of all. So with that in mind, it is good to see, and I think it's worth emphasizing, that Germany and Canada have both committed increased presences in the Baltic states, Germany and Lithuania, and next door in Latvia. Canada has committed a pocket brigade, I think we might refer to it as. It would be great to see that enhanced to a full brigade, and it would be great to see Germany's presence in Lithuania speeded up there. But that's exactly the kind of cooperation where there needs to be a bit more integrated thinking and actually ponying up, putting the numbers, putting the cash behind it to make it work. But ultimately, that's only going to be supported if we have those visions of society that are tangible to enough of our populations to send that signal, that demand signal you mentioned before, to our politicians. And that goes as much for Germany as it does for Canada. And it goes for a lot of other of Western democratic countries as well. So I think it's an interesting role that you mentioned before that we can play in changing the temperature, changing the discourse, in order to actually give narratives and give ammunition to those politicians who do want to lead on this, and to help people to understand why that's the case, so that those arguments land properly in public.
So Ben, a lot to unpack there in that really, really, really great discussion we had with Christian, Jonathan, and Balkan. A few points that really stuck out to me. The first thing is that Canada is obviously a very integral country within our sort of alliance of democracies that is integral to our allies being able to fulfill what I often call the national security premium, what Margaret Vestager, a European commissioner, has called the national security premium. The idea that we invest more in trading with and buying from each other, particularly when it comes to critically important and strategic components that we need for defense, for energy transition, that sort of those sort of critical minerals, rare earths, other resources that we need. But obviously, Canadian leadership at the moment just is not understanding this. And I don't think the Canadian public at the moment either is partly because of that lack of leadership, is understanding the kind of role that Canada can play on the team and that it should play on the team. And we're left with other countries, including Germany, precisely wondering, well, how can we put this point to them? How important is this when it comes to team power that we often discuss on this particular podcast of what Canada can do here?
Well, Aaron, I think you're right to point to leadership as being key there. Leadership and narrativization of what it is that's going on in the world. What are the security challenges that to many Canadians will feel very far away in many ways? But we know that Canada depends to a massive degree on the liberal international order or on liberal and democratic ordering to not only be safe, to not only survive, but to thrive and to make the best of what it can be. And that's something that neither Canada or Germany's leadership have got right in explaining about why we really need to stand up for this more strongly and how we can actually do that by stepping up in terms of defense spending, by stepping up in terms of deploying in the places where our troops need to be, but also, as you said, finding economic opportunities to do more better together, be that on natural resources and energy or on enhancing our trade and finding substitute components and so on to replace our dependencies on countries that we can no longer rely on. And that's something we're going to talk about and talk through in its military context, but also the wider picture of security with Anessa Kimball and Stephanie Carvin in the next part of our episode.
And that's all for this episode of Berlin Side Out, part one of our look at Germany-Canadian relations. Stay tuned later this week for part two, as Ben just said, with Anessa Kimball and Stephanie Carvin. Thank you, as always, to our project assistant, Yulen Stukla, and our technical producer, Henvik Vanna. You can find out more about our guests in the show notes. And remember to stay with us next week as well as we check in with Washington right as election 2024 season in the U.S. kicks off. For now, though, until next time, from Berlin, auf Wiedersehen, tschüss.
Goodbye and au revoir.